Good evening. Your Eminence, Cardinal Tagle, Bishop Bonney, Bishop of Antwerp, honored guest speakers and participants in Lest, all of you, staff and students of our university, ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to Lest 10, dedicated to the theme of the letter and the spirit on the forgotten documents of Vatican II. In the coming days, you will have ample opportunity, thanks to our wonderful speakers, to acquire a more profound knowledge of the Second Vatican Council, a council which is still being appropriated by the Church, and the full significance of which will only be understood by generations far removed from us. We are in the very early stages of appropriating this complex event. The Research Unit of Systematic Theology and the Study of Religions of our university, the research unit responsible for Lest, is very grateful for your presence here and would like to extend to all of you, also in the name of the Faculty of Theology and Religious Studies, a most heartfelt welcome. This is the 10th Lest Conference. We have been doing this for 20 years, and we have never looked back. Lest 11, scheduled for 2017, is already being planned and dedicated to the theme of Ecclesia Semper Reformanda, renewal and reform beyond polemics, under the chairmanship of our colleague, Professor Peter DeMay. Lest is the flagship of our research unit and, dare I say, one of the flagships of our faculty's international profile. And the idea of a flagship, I think, is relevant here because I think the metaphor of a ship is very appropriate to Lest. First of all, each Lest conference has its own captain and a very willing and able crew. And the position is rotated around the members of our research unit. Our captain this year, whom you will soon have the privilege of seeing and hearing, is Professor Anna-Marie Meyer, a commander-in-chief who combines the heartiest laugh one can imagine with tremendous organizational and people skills and a thoroughgoing dedication to excellence in theology. And the crew with whom you have corresponded, and I suppose some of you have already met them, our doctoral students, and they will be available to help you in every way possible. They have shown themselves to be what every captain desires, dedicated, competent, unfailingly polite, and above all, tireless in service to the research unit, to the faculty, and to you. And a second reason, I think, why the metaphor of a ship is appropriate for Lest is that we always venture into uncharted waters. And Lest 10 is, I think, a wonderful illustration of this fact. Amidst all the attention being given to Vatican II worldwide during this anniversary year, we opted to go, for those of you who know Star Trek, we opted to go where no one else dared to go, namely to explore those texts of the Council which are often overlooked, to inquire into their contents and to reflect on their significance. If the Council was, above all, an event that must be continually reappropriated, then we have a duty to reflect on every dimension of that event. Hence our choice of theme. A third and final reason why the metaphor of a ship is so suitable for Lest is the fact that every ship needs a home port, a place where it can be refitted to undertake novel journeys every 2 years. And the members of our research unit share responsibility in this regard, with each of us proposing themes, sharing ideas, and finally entrusting the next voyage of Lest to one of our crew in a spirit of cooperation and friendship. Each voyage is unique, but all those embarking on it know that they can count on support from so many quarters, and especially your presence, which is the most important support we could hope for. And with that in mind, I would like to conclude by thanking the entire crew of this year's Lest, but especially you, all of you who have come from very far, from far and wide, to share this voyage with us. To all of you, then, bon voyage, and I give the word to our admiral, the dean of the faculty, Professor Lambrecht.
This is the admiral speaking. Your Eminence, Your Excellency, dear participants of the Les Cent Conference, chers collègues et amis, liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, liebe Freunde, it is no surprise that this Les Conference will pay ample attention to Vatican II. In his diary on Vatican II, the French theologian Yves Congar wrote, "Primum concilium Lovagnense, Romae habitum." A careful reading of Congar's diary reveals both admiration and irritation about the role of the Belgian bishops and theologians during the Second Vatican Council. Congar expresses his admiration about the fact that the Belgians act as a team in which bishops and theologians closely work together, a real squadra belga. It was one of Congar's greatest disappointments that the French bishops and theologians were not able to develop common initiatives. The Squadra Belga was also admired was the fact that they could easily communicate with other bishops and theologians because they mastered many languages. He admired that they dared to intervene in the conciliar debates, proposed corrections, wrote new schemata even before the official document was discussed, as was the case with regard to the schema De Ecclesia in 1962. Indeed, already in October 1962, weeks before the official document would be discussed in Aula, Cardinal Sunens asked Monsignor Phillips to write a new schema De Ecclesia. The Belgian hospitality in the Belgian College at the Via Quirinale is very much praised. Congar preferred to stay in the Belgian College during the intercessions, not only because of the vibrant atmosphere present at the college, but also because of the good food and the good wine. And, very important, the good beds. Much better than those in the house of the French Dominicans. This hospitality is confirmed by Monsignor Willebrands, at the time of the council, the secretary of the Secretariat for the Promotion of Christian Unity. Indeed, Willebrands, a Dutchman, regularly tried to see Monsignor de Smet of Bruges on a Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. Given the generosity of Monsignor de Smet, he could be sure, this Dutchman, that after the discussion of documents, this Flemish Burgundian would invite him for the aperitif and the lunch in the Belgian College. One of the many examples of a transfer from the south to the north. Of course, Congar also showed irritation. He was of the opinion that the Belgians exaggerated in their admiration for their Leuven Nestor exegete Lucien Serfaux. Congar was somewhat upset that Monsignor Tiltz was practically everywhere and intervened on a regular basis. Edward Schillebeeks, another Dominican, was not happy with the fact that Phillips was so well familiar with the Latin language that he had already a new proposal made before others could propose a correction in the document under discussion. People even criticized the Belgian compromise, often forgetting that thanks to this sense for compromise, Belgium still exists. Even more important, many theologians, including Hans Küng, seem to forget that a council is characterized by a search for unanimity, and this is only possible if people are willing to listen to each other. A council is not a parliament where majority versus minority things are debated and approved. A council is concerned about the well-being of all the faithful and thus respects the differences in opinion. Leuven students at the time of the council were very proud on their professors. Half of the faculty was often in Rome. Students seemingly were also very happy. During the first semester, half of the lectures were cancelled because of the absence of the Leuven theologians. During the second semester, half of the lectures was spent to the conciliar event, and students often received first-hand information about the debates in Rome. Surely, sub secreto, but still. Vatican II created many opportunities. The Council rediscovered the notion people of God, became aware of the fact that the Church should be at the service of the world, wholeheartedly embraced interreligious dialogue and religious liberty, approved the biblical, liturgical, patristic, and ecumenical movements. It very much appreciated the idea of collegiality, even although the post-Vatican II reception proved that there is a huge difference between the appreciation of an idea and the realization of it. Furthermore, one all too often heard desiderata such as the respect for and autonomy of local churches with regard to challenges and problems they were confronted with, which up to today are insufficiently realized or respected. Vatican II not only approved 16 documents, it also invited all members of the people of God to actively contribute to the activities of the Church at the service of the world. To this invitation, our Faculty of Theology and Religious Studies constantly and permanently wants to contribute. As you will see during your visit of the book exhibition, this faculty not only pays much attention to the history of Vatican II as such, this faculty also wants to develop its theological work in line with Vatican II's spirit of openness, dialogue, inviting language, willingness to bring people together. Up to the current day, this faculty aims at making clear that Christ is the Lumen Gentium, not the institutions. Institutions are mere instruments, auxiliary instruments, helping to realize God's dream about humanity as revealed through Jesus Christ. This faculty does its utmost best to keep alive the dream of Saint John the 23rd about aggiornamento and ressourcement. For this reason, this faculty is sometimes described as liberal, even too liberal, a critique that sounds a bit strange to Flemish people, for liberal in this country has the connotation conservative. But we accept both qualifications because we think that liberal refers to liberare, to set free, indeed the core of the message of our Lumen Gentium Christ, and conservative refers to conservare, which means to save, protect, maintain the fides atque religio. In other words, this is the faculty that is welcoming you today. A faculty which really wants to prepare a valuable future for all what was valuable in the past, very well aware that traditions constantly need to be renewed in order to be fruitful for the future. We are also doing this simply because our predecessors did it 50 years ago. Let me conclude by sincerely congratulating the Department of Systematic Theology and Religious Studies with this 10th LEST conference. Indeed, the colleagues of this department have already organized an impressive series of conferences dealing with issues that really matter. Through the organization of these conferences, they have shown that in Leuven, theology is more than an academic enterprise. Theology in Leuven has to do with service to church and society, and I am very grateful for that. That you all, by your presence, subscribe to such program and mission, it makes at least this admiral very happy. I wish you all a fruitful, inspiring conference.
Thank you very much, Professor Lambrex, for your very kind words. We'll consider a promotion for the next LEST. We have a long tradition at LEST of providing our participants with music, which, as you know, soothes hearts and minds. Our guest musician this evening is Miss Laura de Jong. Laura is a well-known harpist who began playing the harp at the age of 10. In 2002, she was awarded her master's diploma in music at the celebrated Lemmens Institute here in Leuven under the tutelage of Lieve Robbrooks, and she pursued further studies in Italy. She is presently a teacher of harp at the Academy for Stage Arts in Ghent, and she combines her teaching career with membership of several ensembles and orchestras throughout Flanders. And while she is a connoisseur of the classic repertory, she is also a lover of contemporary experimental music. This evening, she will provide us with four pieces of music, the first two before we begin our plenary lecture for this evening. She will play for us, first of all, Saraband and Ground by William Croft, and Fantasy on a Theme by Haydn from Marcel Grandjean. Laura, we are very grateful that you were able to be with us this evening. We look very much forward to hearing you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. After this introduction, I feel now very tempted to say, welcome on your cruise through Lest 10. Life jackets are underneath your seat, and in the unlikely event of a drop of cabin pressure, well, perhaps the ceiling is too high. Let's do this in a more formal way. Your Eminence, Your Excellency, mein Herr der Dekan, beste Kollegas und Medewerkers an der Fakultät, dear students, ladies and gentlemen. The letter and the haste over the vergeten documenten van het Tweede Vaticaans Concilie. Don't worry. I limit treating you to my Dutch pronunciation to just stating the title of Lest 10, the letter and the spirit on the forgotten documents of Vatican II. During the Second Vatican Council, Belgian bishops and theologians were playing leading roles as major architects and advocates of several conciliar documents. Names like Gerard Philips, peritus and primary writing, writer of the final text of Lumen Gentium, or Joseph Desmet, are still of vivid memory. Cardinal Sunens was even one of the moderators of the council. Thus, it seems appropriate for theologians in Belgium to take a leading role, this time in fostering the interpretation of the council in an international context. It is often claimed that at the Second Vatican Council, the Catholic Church perceived itself truly as a worldwide church. This is claimed because, for the first time ever, the bishops participating in a council came from all the different regions of the world. And if we have a look at the round of our keynote speakers for Lest 10, this holds also true for the interpretation of the council 50 years after its conclusion at this Lest conference. Our aim is to bring together theologians from different regions of the world and to provide a platform for a common critical reflection on the legacy of Vatican II that can be representative of these regions. And if I look into the whole hall, I think we are quite representative of quite a few regions of this world. In assessing the legacy of the Council and for rendering it still fruitful today, contextualization is a major task. We aim at tracing the outcome of the Council in the different regions of the globe in order to learn how similar challenges are met with in different contexts. Thus, you are all invited to present and discuss your insights on some of the forgotten conciliar documents. Whether they are less familiar to us as theological recipients, or whether they are deliberately or accidentally less intensively received in church official circles, I'd like to leave this question open at the moment and invite further discussion on this issue in the course of the coming days. Yet there is also a second reason for claiming that the Vatican, that at Vatican II, the Catholic Church perceived itself truly as a worldwide church. This council did not conceive of the different dioceses just as districts of a Roman church with the Pope as the world's bishop. It explicitly addressed them as ecclesiae particularis, that are churches in the full sense of the word and are to be heard of in their own right. In the aftermath of the council, no overcoming of centralism really took place. On the contrary, some bishops, to quote Thomas Rees, were behaving and here I quote, like branch managers of a multinational corporation where directives from the top are expected to be obeyed without question. In this context, it sounds like an instance of, let's say, late reception or putting into practice of Vatican II when Pope Francis writes in Evangelii Gaudium 16, here I quote the Pope, nor do I believe that the papal magisterium should be expected to offer a definitive or complete word on every question which affects the Church and the world. It is not advisable for the Pope to take the place of local bishops in the discernment of every issue which arises in their territory. In this sense, I am conscious of the need to promote a sound decentralization. So far, Pope Francis. Yet this would require new orientations that favor the emergence of churches with subject character, and thus, in turn, lend countenance to an ecclesiology of communio. The subject character of each church is related to the position of the individual church, the ecclesia particularis, and its bishop in relation to other particular churches and to the universal church. The bishops should live in communion with one another and with the Roman pontiff in a bond of unity, charity, and peace, says Lumen Gentium 22. And number 23 makes the basic correction in the statement on particular churches, which, I quote, are constituted after the model of the universal church. It is in these and formed out of them that the one Catholic Church exists. And for this reason, precisely, each bishop represents his own church, whereas all together with the Pope represent the whole church in the bond of peace, love, and unity. We can ask ourselves for how long perhaps this might have been a forgotten or less prominent idea. The Second Vatican Council has often been nicknamed the Council of the Church about the Church. In January 1963, Cardinal Montini addressed some young priests, and with regard to the conciliar vision, or rather revision, concerning the Church, he noted, I quote him, "At the Council, the Church is looking for itself. It is trying with great trust and with a great effort to define itself more precisely and to understand what it is. After 20 centuries of history, the Church seems to be submerged by a profane civilization and to be absent from the contemporary world. It is therefore experiencing the need to be recollected and to purify and recover itself as to be able to set off on its own path again with great energy," says Cardinal Montini. And he goes on, "While it is undertaking the task of defining itself in this way, the Church is also looking for the world and trying to come into contact with that society. How should the contact be established? By engaging with the world, interpreting the needs of the society in which it is working and observing the defects, the necessities, the sufferings, and the hopes and aspirations that exist in men's hearts." We all know what came of that. The reception of the Second Vatican Council goes on. Although in a few years' time, Vatican II itself and its dynamics as a historical event will no longer be a part of living memory. On the other hand, Vatican II continues to be a permanent point of reference for generations of Catholics, lay people and ordained alike. The constitutions and decrees of this council and the spirit which animated them have been and continue to be the benchmark by which to judge developments in the Church at the levels of pastoral praxis, doctrinal discernment, and ecclesial decision-making. This makes it all the more important to ask about the Council's reception in our time, to reflect on what scholars would call its Wirkungsgeschichte, the history of its effects. It is imperative to do so not only by looking to the past, but also by inquiring into how the Council can best be implemented in the future. This means reflecting on both the letter and the spirit. To what degree have we realized or failed to realize the program which the Council initiated? How might we go about realizing it in the future? While the documents of Trent and the First Vatican Council always ended in a series of canons and definitions, the Second Vatican Council opted for introducing a new literary genre. Its texts make connections and establish interrelations. Reading them, therefore, requires different hermeneutical tools and methods. The interpretation of the Council consists by no means in just stating the successes and dead ends of the last 50 years. With regard to a worldwide contemporary reception of Vatican II, it becomes clear today that the Catholic Church is entering a new phase. So far, one of the main questions was how to implement the ideas and statements of the Council. Today, the main question to be asked by academic theologians and church leaders alike is, which are the inspirations from Vatican II that will help to address new challenges, above all on a global scale? The questions are different because the problems have changed. Quite often, we cannot look directly for their solutions in the conciliar documents. Instead, we need to look there for principles that can be enacted in the spirit of the Council, while facing the tension between its letter and its spirit. Consequently, our major question is, what can we learn from the Council? To give a practical example, the experience of Vatican II teaches that particular caution is required with regard to process. Because all the schemata prepared by the Roman Curia had to be either repudiated completely or changed fundamentally. Basic decisions thus need synodal discernment and decision making. With the Synod of Bishops on the Family, we are currently living through one of these processes. Also, during this process, of which the sessions were officially concluded yesterday, among the dialogue and discernment, also diplomatic moves, and let's call it certain less welcome interventions, were made, as shows, for instance, the episode of the letter of the 13 cardinals to the Pope, and the fact that it became public. Similar attempts at influencing the process in the aula also happened during the Second Vatican Council. To give just one example, in a letter dated November 20th, addressed to Paul VI, this Met thanked the Pope for his encouragement. He also added some frank remarks. Here I quote, "I fear that during the fourth session, the Declaration on Religious Freedom will be the object of sabotage maneuvers, similar to those it has encountered during these three sessions. Like most of the bishops, I leave Rome profoundly saddened and disheartened by the barely tolerable methods that are constantly being employed by certain influential members of the minority, and that have created an extremely serious prejudice to the honor and the prestige of the Holy Church." This letter by the Smet has been quoted by a certain Luis Antonio Tagle in his chapter on the Black Week of Vatican II from November 14 to 21st, 1964. He further explains, and here I quote Luis Antonio Tagle, "The agitation that characterized the week mainly revolved around four occurrences. First, the postponement of the much-awaited vote on the text on religious liberty. Second, the presentation of a prefatory explanatory note on the modi to the third chapter of the dogmatic constitution on the church, according to which the chapter would have to be understood and voted upon. Third, the introduction of 19 modi to the final text of the decree on ecumenism, with no possibility of discussing them in the council hall. And fourth, the papal declaration of the Marian title, Mater Ecclesiae, Mother of the Church, during the closing ceremonies of the period, a title that the Doctrinal Commission had consistently refused to include in the chapter devoted to Mary in the Constitution of the Church. Tonight's speaker, as you can see, is ideally apt to give this opening talk. He has been a member of the editorial board of the Storia del Concilio Vaticano II at the Istituto per le Scienze Religiose in Bologna from 1995 to 2001, the famous Alberigo School of the Study of History of Vatican II. But let me introduce him properly, chronologically, as it befits someone who was working with Giuseppe Alberigo. He was born, may I say that? He was born in 1957 and hoped to become a medical doctor, yet is said to have felt a calling to become priest on a visit with his parish priest to a very poor parish. He studied in the Philippines at Loyola School of Theology and other places, and the Catholic University of America, Washington, D.C., where he completed his doctorate on the notion of episcopal collegiality according to the Second Vatican Council and the influence of Blessed Paul VI on Vatican II. Back in the Philippines, he taught theology, and in 2001, he became the Bishop of Imus and is currently, since 2011, Archbishop of Manila. In October 2012, he became the youngest cardinal of the world, and as he told me today, even visits his titular church, San Felice da Cantalice, a Centocelle in Rome, which is in the outskirts of Rome, and so he feels there very much at home with the congregation. In 1997, he became a member of the International Theological Commission, where he worked closely together with the then Cardinal Ratzinger. He has been apostolic visitator of seminaries in Papua New Guinea and Solomon Islands, and I vividly recall how you told us about this trip during a breakfast at your house when I visited Manila in 2012. There was a story of a very funny way of how seminarians would communicate among each other, sitting on trees and shouting to each other, "The cardinal is coming, the cardinal is coming." He is a member of the Congregation for Catholic Education since 2012, member of the Pontifical Council for the Family, member of the Pontifical Council for the Laity, and probably this is the real reason why Pope Francis actually creates a new dicastery comprising these two, to leave you a little bit more time with so many tasks. He also is a member of the Pontifical Council for Migrants and Itinerant People, a member of the Congregation of the Institutes of Consecrated Life and Societies of Apostolic Life, and a member of the Congregation for the Evangelization of Peoples and the Pontifical Institution Cor Unum. I hope I haven't forgotten anything. So that's what you have to do for the Vatican. Apart from that, he is president of Caritas Internationalis and a member of the Catholic Biblical Federation. And I think he has to be, he was umpteen times at bishops' synods already. not least at the last one, in a very prominent position. I think he's a very remarkable cardinal because he has his own television show, The Word Exposed, which reflects on the readings of the Mass of each Sunday and tries to answer spiritual questions. And I'm myself not on Facebook, but I was told that on Facebook you are the most popular cardinal as well, with nearly 200,000 likes. 200,000, that's 500,000. 500, oh dear. When did they consult it last time? Well, you see, the point is you can't dislike, so... Once you have liked, one never knows what your colleagues in the cardinalate would want to do at some stage. He is actually famous for not owning a car, but every now and then taking one of the Filipino chipneys, you know, these Filipino minibuses. And I think that's enough from my side now. We are very glad that you could make it and come to Leuven after all this strenuous work during the Synod, with a lot of discussions and a lot of, also work behind the scenes going on, which sometimes wasn't too pleasant, but I think there were also positive moments. Nevertheless, we very much appreciate that you are here today. I know that tomorrow morning you already have to be off because you have another two meetings in Rome tomorrow. So we really enjoy that you are here with us tonight. Thanks a lot for coming. And now the floor is yours for Does the Letter Do Justice to the Spirit? Your Eminence, thank you.
Good evening. Are you awake? Thank you, Captain Anna-Marie. Thank you, Admiral Lambrecht. Thank Your Excellency. Thank you, Terence. Thanks, everyone, for inviting me to LEST 10, the 10th edition of LEST. I have very fond memories of LEST. I was here 10 years ago for LEST that focused on the incarnation and the suffering of the Son of God. And it's good to be back here. I am warning you, I might fall asleep. If you fall asleep, I will forgive you. But please understand if I fall asleep. The subtitle of the talk assigned to me, Does the Letter Do Justice to the Spirit, leads to many other questions. I don't know whether I'll be able to do justice to the topic. Where do I find the Spirit? You know, the Spirit is invisible. So where do I find it? And what Spirit does the letter contain? What Spirit does the letter of Vatican II express? What Spirit does the letter generate? Can the Spirit be found apart from the letter? And if there is a dichotomy between the Spirit and the letter, then where do we find Vatican II? And LEST is also, LEST 10 is also devoted to the forgotten documents of Vatican II. When I look at the list of those forgotten documents, I don't see Dei Verbum or Lumen Gentium and Gaudium et Spes as though we are presupposing that they have not been forgotten. Or maybe they are the most forgotten. I don't know. I want to make a very humble contribution to Lest. I don't even want to pretend that I will solve the riddle, the question. My humble contribution is this. It's very tentative, and I'm inviting you to explore it. And if it does not help, then feel free to ignore it. My proposal is this. After having read a bit of the history of Vatican II, of course, the role played by John the 23rd, the preparatory stages, the conciliar discussions and debates, the time of Pope Paul VI. And then you go to the documents that had been promulgated and the various forms of appropriation or reception, whether official reception or the liturgical, canonical, curial reception, the various regional receptions of the council, and the hidden, unheralded receptions happening in the homes, happening in parishes. After looking at all of those, I propose that the letter and spirit of Vatican II could be viewed and investigated from the perspective of its being a pastoral council. What does it mean to be pastoral? What does it mean for a council to generate a church that desires to be pastoral? For it would be an anomaly if a council is called pastoral and the church that emerges from it is not pastoral. But what does that mean to be pastoral? I see a lot of students here. I've been a teacher myself for a number of years now, and I continue teaching theology when I have time. When you ask difficult questions, some students will say, "Your Eminence, I don't think I need to study that. I intend to be a pastoral priest in the future." That will not please the admiral. But really, what does it mean to be pastoral? What does the council mean when its spirit is permeated by that vision and desire? The search, no matter how tentative, to be a pastoral council, I think is crucial. For it is at the heart of the desire of the council to unleash faith and missionary zeal in the contemporary world. I admit this is not the only prism that could be used to determine the spirit animating the letter and the event of Vatican II. But it could be useful in appreciating and even critically evaluating the documents and the renewal that the Council has effected so far. How did Vatican II envision a pastorally responsive church? How did this pastoral vision of Vatican II surface in the debates and in the documents? What types of pastoral church have emerged since Vatican II and in fact claiming to have imbibed the spirit of Vatican II. If you are in a diocese with 1,000 priests, I'm sure you will have 1,000 understandings of pastoral. But let us try. Is that okay? Now let me go to the main body of my sharing. The various areas of being pastoral. This is far from exhaustive. I did not have time to really go to the archives and to consult Professor Lamberich on this. But to talk about being pastoral is to touch on relationships. In fact, if we move for a while from the council and go to an individual who calls himself a pastor, pastoral is not the characteristic so much of an activity. Pastoral is what you are and what you become. And no matter how many activities you do or engage in, those activities may not be at all pastoral in nature, in inspiration, and in spirit. Relationships matter. The church's relationships with various interlocutors or dimensions of the faith and ecclesial life would, I think, help us understand the pastoral spirit of Vatican II. First, the relationship of the Council of the Church to revelation, or to what was loosely called doctrine, or sometimes deposit of faith. We don't have time to delineate, you know, all of these terms, but let us, just for the purposes of this conference, to just take them, you know, under one umbrella. Divine truth, revelation, doctrine, the deposit of faith. When the council talks about divine truth in revelation, it is careful not to treat divine truth in a conceptual or notional manner. And this is very clear in Dei Verbum number 2. When the council talks about divine revelation and the truth that it contains, it goes back to God. God chose to reveal God's self and to make known to us God's purpose. Revelation is a speech. It's a speech of love coming from a God who dialogues, a God who speaks, but a God who listens, and a God who knows the potential hearers. It is a speech of love, inviting the hearers to intimate communion. Because it is God, God's will, and God's invitation to a living relationship with us, the so-called sacred deposit of faith is to be safeguarded and taught in a more efficacious way, according to St. John the 23rd. It is not the preservation of an idea, of a concept. It is saving truth that is at stake here. And as saving truth, it must touch the various areas of human activity, of human life. It must touch the family. It must touch society. It must touch the deepest recesses of the human person. Because of the saving thrust of revelation, the divine truth must address the present situation of human beings in their new situations and in their new ways of living. It is in this context, truth that is alive because it is God who speaks. It is God who makes God's self known. It is because of this that Pope John the 23rd, in his famous opening speech at the council, says, "We are safeguarding this truth, but not as a precious treasure of antiquity." That is not the approach to divine truth. He says, the council should not just repeat details that we already know. The council should not repeat details the theologians and past councils had already said. We're not talking about details. We're talking about God who reaches out to God's people. I think I'm giving a retreat here. We're still in Vatican II, huh? The forgotten document. So, being pastoral, if we just pause here, no? Being pastoral is serving the God who reveals God's self. Being pastoral is serving the God who speaks a saving, loving word to the human soul. Being pastoral is allowing God's word to be the soul of the church's missionary and pastoral activity. That's very clear in Dei Verbum. Being pastoral is trusting in the power and the beauty of God's word. Being pastoral is humbly facilitating people's access to God's word. Now, a critical question. Verbum Domini, which we can consider as one reception of the spirit and text of Vatican II, says that the biblical apostolate should not be one apostolate alongside the other apostolates in the diocese or the parish, but must animate all the apostolate. Is that happening? Or has the church forgotten Dei Verbum? Another critical question. Pope John the 23rd said, one thing is the deposit of faith, the truth contained in the doctrine. And another thing is the mode or manner with which it is proclaimed. Now, can you change the mode and manner without touching the core? I see some saying. Now discuss that these coming days. This type of questioning surfaced not in exactly this way, formulated this way during the synod. No? And Bishop Boni is nodding here. Thank you for supporting me. The so-called essentialists, no, are the essentialists, classicists, quite right in their intuition in opposing new expressions for fear that when you have new expressions, you might be touching or even adulterating the core. This last question that I have somehow led to the compromise, the compromises used in Vatican II. Professor Pottmeyer, Herman Pottmeyer, said Vatican II could be considered as a transitional council. Many of the doctrines have been expressed not in a synthetical way, but in a way that allowed persuasions, different persuasions, to stand alongside each other. And he considers it quite positively, looking at the context of Vatican II. Like, for example, you have an expression, hierarchical communion. So the hierarchy is preserved, but then you bring in communion. Now, what exactly is hierarchical communion? They say, it is what it is. Now tell me, what is the spirit and what is the letter there? Hierarchical communion. Now, for many people, they'll say that's a failure of Vatican II. It failed to synthesize concepts. But Professor Pottmeyer says, well, let us be realistic. That was what the council could afford to do at that time. And he said, that's even positive. No position is now absolutized. With another concept beside it, you have an equilibrium of some sort and relativized positions. I think this is also being pastoral. Being at ease with gray areas. The humility to allow questions to remain open. Pope Paul VI, in the closing speech of the council, said, December 7, 1965, if some questions remain in need of adequate response, this indicates not la stanchezza, not the tiredness at the coming, at the closing of the council, but it expresses the vitality that this council has awakened. He believes that this vitality will perdure, and let time experience that vitality, and a time will come when open-ended questions will find their proper response. It's fatal for a pastor to have to want questions answered immediately, clearly. Being pastoral is not putting a cursor before the face of a parishioner and saying, I give you 3 seconds, 1, 2, 3, I delete you. No. Part of being a pastor is, okay, you know that life will go on. In fact, people are asking me, what happens, what's happening to your archdiocese now that you're always out? I've been out for 6 years now. 6 months now, I mean, six weeks now. See, I'm getting confused. 6 years, 6 months, 6 weeks. From the papal visit to the United States, the synod, now Belgium. I say, well, I think it's running better. Bishop, please don't follow my bad example. But really, I was very, very much amazed reading again the closing speech of Pope Paul VI. It's not procrastination. It is not blind abandon. It is an act of humble faith. The vitality of this council will perdure, even if in 1965 we don't have clear answers yet. This is the first relationship with the revealed truth, relationship with what we call the deposit of faith. The second is the relationship of the world, of the council, of the church, to the world, to history, or better still, to human beings. When Pope John the 23rd, when Pope Paul VI and the council talks about the world, it is not just the geographic space, but it is the world constructed by human beings. It is the world of human beings. The contemporary world, the modern world, with its contradictions, with its blindness, with its anguish, with its violence, with its pride, with the tremendous suffering of human beings, this world, this history, is the place where the church will embrace humanity. Pope John the 23rd, again in the opening speech, says there are a lot of prophets of doom. They see only ruin and darkness in the world. And they have a nostalgia for an idealized past, where everything in the past looked better than what we see in the present. And he says, I am not inclined to listen to those prophets of doom. He says, they have not learned from history, which is the great teacher of life. Because of this hopeful, positive view of the world, this broken world remains God's world. God has not abandoned this world. God is there. And because of that, according to Pope John the 23rd, the church prefers to use the medicine of mercy instead of the medicine of severity. In the Italian version, it says, instead of embracing the world with rigorous arms. Instead of embracing the world with tender arms, you experience a hug like that from some of the professors. You say, oh. Hi, Admiral. Oh, where am I? I lost my... And it says, we explain the value of the teaching rather than condemning people. So he says, and Pope Paul VI will use this a number of times, show to them, especially those who are confused and in error, show to them the beauty, the attractiveness of the teaching, rather than just condemning them in their error. And especially to those separated from the church. Show the maternal face of the church. Patience, kindness, goodness, especially to those facing difficulties. Don't hate the world. It's already wounded. Love it. It is God's world. Paul VI says, the religion, he used the word religion, the religion of our council is principally love. Love. And this cannot be, according to him, and the council cannot be accused of irreligiosity and infidelity to the gospel if its religion is love. The council focuses on the human being of today as he or she is today. For to know God requires knowing the human person. Wow. I could almost hear Les Miserables. To see and to love another person is to see the face of God. Now, the all familiar lines of Gaudium et Spes, the joys and hopes, the griefs and anxieties of the people of our times are those also of the followers of Christ. And the church is not motivated by earthly ambition in the church's approach to the world. No, it is simply to carry out the work of Christ. To be pastoral is to believe that the broken world, broken humanity, is still loved by God. To be pastoral is to convey the beauty and attractiveness of the gospel in the church's loving, merciful embrace of humanity, rather than constantly blaming those who are already confused. To be pastoral is to trust in God and to trust in humanity. The words of Pope Paul VI. May I continue? I'm close to the end. So, the relationship with divine revelation, relationship with the world, and now, the church, the internal relationship of the church, which is reflected in its exterior relationship, what Cardinal Sunan should say, the ad intra and the ad extra. Here, it's simply communion. I read one article that says, the only politics allowed in the church is that of communion. Any canon lawyers here? That's the politics allowed in the church, communion. As our admiral so beautifully reminded us in Vatican II, the church is not the light of the world. Lumen Gentium is not the church. The church is not the light to the nations. It is Jesus Christ who is the light. And Vatican II reminds the church, hey, wake up. Do not pretend to be the light. The early ecclesiastical writers would even talk about the lunar ministry of the church. The church is the moon, possessing no light of its own, but turning to the sun. But the church must keep its communion with the sun for it to have some brightness, not its own, but refracted to the world from the sun. The church is a humble sign and instrument, like a sacrament, of humanity's intimate relationship with God and the unity within humanity. And more concretely, the unity of different cultures, peoples of different tongues, of different traditions, different histories. For humanity, the church is a universal communion of local communities, showing the world that love unites. It is a communion that recognizes elements of sanctification and truth outside its visible structures. Lumen Gentium, number 8. Paul the VI says, this church is in dialogue with community, bearing the voice of pastoral charity. And he says, look at the spirit here. He says, this communion of the church with humanity must be conducted in a style of ordinary conversation. The church must know how to talk. When people say, I think it will rain, the church must be able to say, yes, it will rain. It will not say, eschatologically, no. Oh. I stop there. There is a time for that language. But when humanity is before the church, says, engage in ordinary conversation. Touch lived experience. For when you speak coming from lived experience, you become more persuasive. And there is only one direction in this conversation. It is to serve humanity. The idea of service occupies a central position in the council. So, being pastoral is being a servant of communion within the church, among Christians, and with the whole of humanity. Being pastoral is being a servant. So those are the three levels that I have identified in terms of being pastoral, the council as a pastoral council. And I'm offering them to you to see whether those things are present in all the documents. Because it can happen that in one document you have a mixture of tones, a mixture also of spirits. And I will devote this last 10 minutes or so. Can you still stand? No, another 10 minutes of me here. Here. Yeah. Going to the present. For I think it is incumbent upon us, we who live with a certain proximity to the council, to continue receiving the council, appropriating the council, rediscovering in changing times and challenges this spirit, which is a legacy to us. I see the young faces here. Unlike us, I did my first Holy Communion before Vatican II. So I had a bit of memory of the church before Vatican II. No, but most of you know only one church or sociological form of the church, if you want to put it that way. The church already inspired by Vatican II. But it is our mission to continue, you know, discovering, rediscovering this spirit in the letter, being critical, and also imbibing it and hopefully living it. As a transitional council, with a lot of compromises, the documents of Vatican II contain different understandings and spirits of being pastoral. And I'm inviting you to look into all of those elements. The period after Vatican II must be characterized by a continuing search for an adequate pastoral identity and spirit in our activities and mission in the world. I want to give you some examples. Paul VI renounced the papal tiara for the poor. The inauguration of the papal ministry then included the coronation of the Pope, the tiara. Paul VI, with the influence, they said, of the group of Cardinal Ercaro and the commune and companions, the Church of the Poor, decided to renounce the tiara. And then he became the pilgrim pope, going to different parts of the world. And he had these great ecumenical gestures. But then some people say, but we cannot understand why his language in Humanae Vitae was like that. The truth that he was proclaiming was prophetic. But some were saying, why was that prophetic message quoted in a language that was quite different from the conversational dialogue that he himself advocated? John Paul II, ut unum sint, wow, inviting the church, help us discover new expressions of the papacy. Earlier, Pope Paul VI even said that the greatest stumbling block to union among Christians is the papacy. And Pope John Paul II says, oh, let us reflect on this. Then the great gathering in Assisi of leaders of various groups, his pleas against war, the only candle burning there, praying that Iraq would not be bombed. But then some people say, how does that blend with the language of Dominus Jesus and the language of Communionis Notio? So we could see that even after the council, there is this search. What does it mean to be pastoral? The synods of bishops. People ask me, how was this recently concluded synod? I said, oh, normale. It's normal. I've been to six synods. Five as a bishop, and the first one as one of the so-called experts. And you could see, I could almost sense the Second Vatican Council in miniature. The diversity of opinions, the diversity of cultural and existential experiences, all leading to this. Sometimes you have very fiery words and even action. But last year and this year, I was one of the president delegates. How do I keep my cool? How do I keep a sincere, genuine smile on my face all throughout? I just think to myself, these people, even if they differ from each other, they all love Jesus. They all love the church. They all love humanity. They all love the family. And when I think that way, I can smile again. I try to search for the spirit. And even if the pastoral expression may differ, I try to convince myself they're trying to be pastoral in their own ways, but I hope we could listen to one another and rediscover the spirit of being pastoral as taught to us by Vatican II. In Asia, the triple dialogue, remember Pope Paul VI, first encyclical, Ecclesiam Suam, promulgated within the council, was on dialogue. And that was picked up by the bishops of Asia. The programmatic dialogue, triple dialogue with cultures, with religions, with the poor. Yeah, but sadly, in many parts of Asia, the dialogue partners don't want to dialogue. How do you keep the spirit? I cannot mention countries, but you know, there are countries where Christians are forbidden from using some words. Some words in the vernacular are reserved for some religious groups. I was talking with one bishop who told me, we just received a notice from the government. 31 words cannot be used now by Christians. How do you dialogue? How do you keep the spirit when you are hated? Pope Francis, his language, his style, saying, "Who am I to judge?" Some people clapped their hands. Some said, "Why does he not speak like the vicar of Christ?" Somebody asked me, "Do you believe in the Antichrist?" I said, "I've heard of the Antichrist, but I don't know if I believe in it." And then I asked the person, "Why are you asking?" He said, "I think Pope Francis is the Antichrist." So what made you say that? He says, "He does not use red shoes." I'm sure this person loves the church, but he loves the church by imposing red shoes. So tomorrow, those who will attend the last seminars, please wear something red if you love the church. The social message of the gospel. No? And if you look at the encyclical Laudato Si, the exhortation Evangelii Gaudium, Pope Francis quotes the statements from various episcopal conferences instead of quoting himself and quoting his homilies and writings. A new way of integrating communion into a papal document. Would a papal reception of Vatican II's pastoral vision ensure a similar reception worldwide? He is interpreting the spirit of Vatican II. But will it translate into a worldwide reception of the same spirit? Let me close. By sharing with you, last Monday, I went to Greece to visit a transit point for the refugees. It was on the border with Macedonia, or what's the official? Phyrum, former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia. I went there for Caritas. I told the Holy Father, as I am not familiar with the diplomatic relationships of the Vatican with Greece and Phyrum, but he says, just go, show them love, Caritas, love. And right there, we saw groups and of refugees. You could smell misery. You could see tiredness. Some had nothing except their clothes and the most precious to them, their families, their children. One teenager looked at me and asked me, "Are you a Muslim?" I said, "No." But then he could not take his eyes off of me. And I wondered what he was thinking of. Was he marveling that this Muslim is giving him food? Was he getting afraid? But I just kept smiling, assuring him that we are here to help. And as he moved, his eyes were fixed on me. But in the midst of that misery, you also see a lot of humanity. I failed to take a photo of this father. Looked very tired, very, very tired. But his daughter wanted to play. And so he allowed the girl, the little girl, to play with his face. No. And the girl was having a grand time, and you could see the father trying to stay awake for the sake of the daughter. There. The spirit of Vatican II.
Radiance grows and increases. And so it seems, do your responsibilities. We wanted you to speak about the spirit of the Council and its relationship to the letter, and we knew you would not disappoint us, but we had not expected you to incarnate the Council spirit and to make the letter come alive in the way that you did. It's precisely what you have done, reminding us that the Council was, above all, about relationship. The relationship between a loving God and an often loveless world, and also about the relationship between a broken and vulnerable world and a church whose primary duty is to be its pastor and, as far as possible, to bind up its wounds. I think it's wonderful that we had you here, because you have, at the very outset of this conference, reminded us of what theology is all about. We can sometimes forget that in the many intense academic discussions that will, I'm sure, follow in the coming days. And I think that the spirit of your lecture is hardly the right word. The spirit of your words this evening will stay with us for the coming days. We regret very much, of course, that you won't be able to be with us, but I think you have left us with a legacy that will carry us far beyond these days. Thank you so very, very much. So that you don't forget us and that you enjoy a little of the time to come, we have a little offering for you of Belgian chocolates and a keychain that carries the Sede Sapientiae of our university. Thank you so much. And to help us reflect somewhat on Cardinal Tagle's words, we would invite Laura de Young to take her place again. She will play two pieces for us, Bourré by Johann Sebastian Bach, and a very promising way to end the evening, I think, Danza Cubana from Alfredo Orlando Ortiz. Laura, thank you. Thank you very much, Laura, for your spirited performance and for sharing your time and your talent with us this evening. We're very grateful. Ladies and gentlemen, we have more or less completed our first formal evening of Lest, and thanks to a very long-standing tradition, we are now able to invite all of you to a reception in the Jubilee Hall right next door, just follow the crowd. From the beginning of Lest in 1995, we have been supported and sustained by the goodwill and the generosity of Peters, publishers, represented in 1995, I remember it well, and today by Mr. Paul Peters, who has continued the work and the legacy of his parents. Peters publishers have fed the minds and mouths of all who support and attend and learn from Lest by publishing its texts and providing the wonderful receptions which have always followed our plenary opening session. They do so again this year, and on this 10th anniversary, and after 20 years of putting up with us and waiting for us to make the appointments and get everything arranged, they have always faithfully supported and sponsored us. And especially in this year, I would like to thank them on behalf of the research unit and on behalf of the faculty, for whom they do so much. I wish to thank them for their support this evening, but also for their continuous support for the last 20 years. And it's their reception offered to you. And I thank you on behalf of everyone present, Paul, and your parents as well. Thank you very much, and I look forward to seeing you.